Okay. I think I see 10 a.m. in my clock, so let's get started. I am Balachander, along with Alfredo Soldati. We are the co-editors of International Journal of Multiphase Flow, and this spotlight seminar is a simple way of us getting people together. Today we have the third talk of the fall series. And the moderator for this talk is Professor Marco Marengo. I will let him introduce the speaker and chair the session. Marco, it's yours.
Thank you, Bala. Thank you, Bala. So welcome everybody to this webinar today. Our speaker today is Carole Planché. She has been working at the Institute of Fluid Mechanics and the transfer at Graz University of Technology in Austria. And then first as a university assistant and then recently as a professor assistant. She has worked with great results, I can say, on the experimental and theoretical results of liquid fragmentation, drop impact, drop encapsulation, drop collisions. She is a co-author of various important papers in Journal of Fluid Mechanics. And so I'm eager to hear Carole and her presentation. Please, Carole.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to the organizers to having invited me and to having given me this opportunity to talk in this seminar. I'm very happy about that. Thank you, our Marco, for the kind introduction. And I'm going to start sharing my slide so that we can start. So today, the topic of this talk is actually about fragmentation thresholds in drop collisions. And the context of this talk is actually the following. So historically speaking, people got interested into droplet collisions and the result of this collision in terms of coalescence or fragmentation due to meteorological interest. So in a cloud, you have this assembly of water droplet, and you would like to know if this droplet size distribution is going to increase or decrease depending what's going on in terms of collision inside the cloud. So this was basically pioneering work from Ashkritz and Poo, and then it has been, of course, translated into different other kind of droplet assemblies, so different sprays that you can have in spray drying for pesticides that you spray on crops or for any cosmetic spray or anything. You can also think of combustions, yeah? And always the questions are about the same. This is about describing the process. So for that, you have two droplets of equal sizes. They have a certain diameter D. They have a certain relative velocity U. You can describe the eccentricity of the collision here by looking at the distance between these two centers and normalize this by the diameter. So that's the so-called impact parameter. In order to describe this process fully, you have to add the liquid properties. And with this all together, you can build basically three-dimensionless parameters, your Weber number that compare the inertia to the capillary contribution, your Onnes-Sorge number or Reynolds number, so that you can introduce some viscosity into the system, and this geometrical impact parameter that tells you if the collision is head-on when it is zero or if it is off-center or grazing for one. And the state of the art when I started to look at this system was the following. Typically in the literature, you fix the Onnes-Sorge number. So you have a certain liquid and a certain drop size. And for this fixed Onnes-Sorge number, you can build regime maps. They look like this, and they are two dimensional. Here you have the Weber number, and here you have your impact parameter. And then you recognize typically four regimes. Either the droplets are bouncing. This is what is illustrated here. If you increase a bit the inertia here, you have the drainage of this liquid film here, and the droplets are merging, and they remain merge, so you have coalescence, that would be this area of the regime map. If you further increase the inertia here, but you stay, let's say, with a small eccentricity, you have the so-called reflexive separation. And if you have comparable high inertia, but now off-center collision, so a higher eccentricity, you have this stretching fragmentation. So that's basically historically what people used to do with droplet collision. And recently, there were some more questions or some more interests that were coming, which are due to the fact that people started to say, okay, in these assemblies of droplet where the trajectories are not controlled, there happen these coalescence, and we would like to know what happens. But we could also make use of this collision in order to use the droplet as microreactors or to make capsules. So the idea now is to control the trajectory of these droplets and to control the collision parameters in order to produce a certain type of collision and so to produce a certain type of outcome. So this was first done in microfluidics. This is the sketches you have here. So typically with these microfluidic devices, you can control the trajectory of the droplet, you can force them to merge like here, and so you can do this, what I was mentioning. But you have the intrinsic problem of microfluidic is you need a chip which needs to be designed, manufactured. It clogs because the dimensions are so small. That limits, of course, the possibility to scale up for industry, and you still need this carrying phase that basically is carrying your droplets. So this was proposed to get rid actually of this chip and of this carrying phase, and just to make what is called in-air microfluidics, so to have the droplet colliding, but in air. Here, this is the pioneering work by the group of Bassaran, where they use two aqueous stream of droplets and made this kind of capsules. But of course, if you want to enrich this process, you quickly come to the question, what happens if you use immiscible liquid? What happens if you are using more than two liquids, or two droplets, sorry. And that's basically a bit what I would like to review today with you. So how can we generalize the fragmentation threshold, which we have seen in this basic map of the binary drop collision? And first, can we find here a unifying way to describe this head-on fragmentation process that would apply not only to two drops, one liquid, but also to other situations? And the second part of my talk will be about the fragmentation thresholds between the coalescence and the stretching separation here with the same idea. Can we have a general approach to describe this that would be so general that we could apply it beyond the two-drop, one-liquid collision configuration? So to answer these questions and to review a bit this kind of impacts, I've been using experiments which basically produce all with the same kind of setup, which you see here. So we have independent liquid supply that we can connect to two or three of these droplet generators. We can look at this using mainly a stroboscopic light and a camera, just to fix a bit the order of magnitudes our droplet that typically have between 100 and 800 micron in diameters. And we can so adjust the trajectories, et cetera, that we are adding here clean and accurate collisions. So let me start with the first part of my talk, which is what about this head-on fragmentation limit? Is there a way to describe it generally enough that it can be used not only for two droplets, one liquid, but for other cases? So what you see here actually on the left is a solution of glycerol in water. And you see from the left movie to the right movie, it's only the relative velocity between the droplet that is a bit increased. And you see the transition between the coalescence I was mentioning on the very left and this so-called reflexive separation on the right, which I will also call head-on fragmentation. If you do this with three droplets now, that's the same liquids, pretty much the same sizes for the droplets. And you can also produce exactly the same kind of regimes. So meaning here you have the permanent coalescence of the free droplet. They are merged, and if you would wait long enough here, you would have one spherical droplet at the end. Or you can increase the inertia in such a way that this merged entity is then separating into main droplet and some satellite in the middle. And this can be even further extended to two immiscible liquids. So here again, the glycerol solution is the dark one, but now the transparent liquid you see here is some silicone oil. And you see that in one case, you have the encapsulation of one drop by the other one, while in the other case, they do separate or fragment afterwards. So this is basically three different situations with two or three drops and one liquid, or two drops and two liquids. And actually, this is quite similar, and except for the relative liquid distribution that we would have here for the coalescence, of course, it is mixing, while for the immiscible liquid, it's an encapsulation instead. There are also differences here with the reflexive separation, so that the liquid that arrive on this side is expelled on that side, on the same side, while for immiscible liquid, this is actually crossing. Yeah, this is the opposite. But except for this kind of differences, which a priori are not essential, it looks very similar. So I tried with this in mind to develop a common approach to describe the hadron fragmentation of droplets that are colliding. And this is based basically on the sketch you have here. So we can say that every droplet is like a liquid spring. These two liquid springs, they get basically they impact on each other. So that leads to the compression of these two or three springs that has a certain duration, till this TD max, and it reaches then a certain maximum diameter extension. So this thing here, which I call sometimes a disc, is actually a very thin lamella that is surrounded by a toroidal rim. And then in the second phase, you have this kind of compressed spring here that is going to relax. This is happening here, and it relaxes in the shape of a seagull or something like that. Yeah, and which has on which we can basically define a certain length and a certain diameter, so that one can build up here an aspect ratio. And the idea would be then to use to this seagull shape entity, a kind of a criterion, Plato Rayleigh criterion, so that if we are below a critical aspect ratio, it remains one merged droplet. And if we are above, then we have fragmentation. And so that's the basic idea of the approach. How good does it work? Well, let me first look at this maximum time of extension. Without going too much into the details, the data that I have plotted here, this is this maximum time of extension that is normalized by what I call the oscillation time. That's just a fraction of the Rayleigh oscillation period. And what you see, the crosses are for two liquids, two droplets, one liquid. The gray symbol are three droplets, one liquid. The empty symbols are when we have two droplets, two liquids, but basically above a certain Weber number, typically 50, that works very well like these springs. And you even have between two and three droplet ratio of the slope of two-thirds, like when you would have two or three springs in series. So that seems to work very well. If you go to lower inertia, then you have to add some contribution in terms of D over U, a typical geometrical time. But this is not so relevant for us because the separation is always occurring at in the region where the inertia is larger than that. Good, so we have quite some similarities in terms of maximum extension time. Do we have similarities in term of losses that are happening in this first compression phase? And there we have to do an energy balance. So this is the approach I was following in order to answer this question. And what I'm comparing is the initial situation here. So with two or three droplets with a certain kinetic energy, which is known, a certain surface energy, it is known. And then the disk like, or the compressed like state, let's say, where there is most likely, or there, a priori, there is some kinetic energy. So we don't know if we can neglect it or not for now. There is some surface energy, which we can measure from our picture. That's actually just a function of this maximum diameter. And there will be losses, which actually we are interested in. About the kinetic energy of the disk, there were numerical simulations that were done in collaboration with us by the group of Dieter Bothe, and it was shown that when this disk is reaching its maximal extension, there is actually no kinetic energy that can be neglected at this stage. So then the question was if we could estimate this surface energy, and without going into the details, we have shown also that for two droplets, one liquid, three droplets, one liquid, or two droplets, two liquids, you can very much approach this very accurately. So this we can also do. And so we can use now this equation in order to calculate the energy which has been lost during this first compression phase and try to see if it has the same pattern or the same behavior for this different kind of collision. And what you see when you plot this dissipated energy here as a function of the initial kinetic energy for two drops, one liquid, three drops, one liquid, or two different liquids, you always have a linear relation. So these losses are purely inertial and they are just equal to a certain fraction of your initial kinetic energy, which is quite astonishing, but also quite great because that makes the modeling quite straightforward. And so the next question is, can we explain or can we model, predict what's the fraction of the initial kinetic energy that is lost in this first phase? So yes, we can. I don't want to go too much into details because today I just would like really to give you more the impression about the approach, and we can discuss this further. But basically, we can split the losses of three kinds. Those who are taking place here in the viscous boundary layer, in the lamella before the rim. These are the blue ones, yeah, if I can say so. Those that are taking place into the rim here, that would be this expression here. And in the case where there are small Onesorgen number, actually the viscous boundary layer that is here, it does not really have time to develop. So you have to adapt a bit the formula here to a not developed viscous boundary layer, and you end up to a slightly different scale. But again, how you get this scaling is not really the point. You can check this in the paper. What's important is to see that it works very well. So that basically on this plateau here, where the blue losses are dominating, this A, the fraction of kinetic energy that is dissipated, is just a constant. It's about actually 60%, 65%. If you go to higher, so to smaller Reynolds number, you go here to the right, you have to add losses that are taking place in the rim. And if on the opposite, you are having very small Onesorgen number, then actually your viscous boundary layer does not develop, but you expect to have a scaling like the square root of the Onesorgen number. That is what you see here. So that works very well for two drops, one liquid. And actually that works very well for also three drops, one liquid. These are these gray points. So you have again this plateau, and then at a certain point you start to enter in a viscous regime, so it starts to increase. Sorry. And it also works very well for immiscible liquid collision. There, the fraction of the initial kinetic energy that you lose is higher, but this is expected because you have really a tiny film of oil around, and so the velocity gradients you have there are expected to be bigger. So this works. So the next question is, can we basically apply such a very, very simple, actually, fragmentation criterion that is based simply on the aspect ratio of this cigar? And the answer is yes. So here again, you have the data that are obtained for binarily collision with one liquid, for ternary collision, so three droplets, one liquid, or for different kind of collisions that are involved in two immiscible liquids. And you see again that you have a critical value of this aspect ratio around three. at least till a certain Onesorge number, then you enter in a viscous regime, that something else happens. Good, so last but not least, we know what's going on here. We know that our fragmentation criterion is working. So the only thing I can formulate it this way that is missing is to describe the relaxation process between this very compressed spring to basically this cigar. So there, again, I don't want to go into the detail of the three different configurations. I just would like to convince you that they enter into a unified approach that can be followed for all of them the same way. And this unified approach is the following. One make, again, an energy balance between the disk, which is here, which has only surface energy, because we said we could neglect the kinetic one, and then basically the energy of this cylinder that will have a kinetic part, a surface part, a capillary part, and there will be in between some losses due to the viscosity. So we say when we have the fragmentation limit, so that this cylinder basically really stop extending at the moment of fragmentation or is not extending very much. So we make again the assumption that there is no kinetic energy or not an important contribution of the kinetic energy inside with this internal flow in the cylinder. Then we make use of the result I was just showing you so that the energy we have in the disk can be written in this form, where A is just the fraction of the initial kinetic energy which has been lost in this compression phase. Then we need to estimate the energy that is dissipated during this relaxation phase. And there, the key point, without going into the detail again to evaluate this, is simply to say that the velocity at which this relaxation is taking place is simply the amplitude, so the maximum length, divided by the time of oscillation, so this typical relay oscillation period. And the second important thing here, what one needs to take is to apply this critical aspect ratio of free together with volume conservation as our fragmentation criterion. And one can basically apply this same method for the three different kinds of collisions. And what you would obtain is the following. Here I show it for the immiscible liquid cases. So in this case, you count the viscosity only in the oil, that is the outside film. You have this velocity gradient, which I was mentioning with H would be the thickness of the film. This is the volume in which you integrate these losses and the time. And you find typically critical velocity, that's scales like that. So that it's only a function of the viscosity of the oil. That's like what you see here with an exponent of 0.5, the square root. The viscosity of the water, so of the encapsulated liquid, the one that is inside, is not playing any role. And the diameter of the droplet come more or less with an exponent minus 3/4. So that works very well. And again, without going into the detail, you can expand this to the two and three droplets, one liquid situation. So you have, in this case, some losses that are happening here when you relax into this cylinder with, again, this velocity gradient squared, the volume, and the typical time. And actually, there are some additional losses here in the torus that you have to add if you want to be more precise. And what you find is a very good agreement between the experimental critical velocity, which separates the coalescence from the fragmentation, and the theoretical ones for two droplets and also for three droplets here. So just to conclude about this first part, which deals with the head-on fragmentation of the droplets, my message here is, without again going in the detail of every scaling law that is specific to this or that configuration, there is a general frame, a unifying frame, which you can use to predict this head-on fragmentation, and that is based on this scheme here. So you have a first compression phase where you build up this kind of disk of lamella with the rim around with purely inertial losses. And then this lamella is then going to relax into a cylinder. And whenever this cylinder has an aspect ratio that is above a critical value, you get fragmentation. And when it is below, you get better coalescence or encapsulation. And this is true for two droplets, two liquids, two droplets, one liquid, and three droplets, one liquid. So that's a quite powerful approach, actually, and that unifies a bit this three different configuration in one frame. But what I also wanted to discuss today is not only the fragmentation threshold you have here, it's the so-called stretching separation. And these results are more recent, and they're actually only published in archive at the moment. And I'm going to show you that we can also have here a very, very simple and powerful approach. So how general is this stretching separation process? Well, indeed it is, again, quite general. So here it is illustrated for two droplets, one liquid, with this part of the droplet that are continuing onto their initial trajectory, and then the ligament in the between that gets stretched and then would detach. You observe something similar if you use the same liquid but add a third droplet into the process. And here, this is what you would see for using, again, immiscible liquids. So the same two liquids I've been showing you now, so the glycerol solution with the silicone oil. And it looks always pretty much the same. Can we have such a simple or such a straightforward unified description as we had for the head-on fragmentation? Let's see. So the idea again is to have some kind of a critical elongation. So you have these two droplets, they come together, they make this deformed entity here. And the idea would be to measure here the maximum length this ligament is taking, which I call here HD, and normalize it by the droplet diameter here D, and look what's the maximum. And if there is here a kind of maximum extension criterion, then one would only need basically to predict the evolution of this aspect ratio as a function of the collision parameters, so the velocity of the droplet, the impact parameter, the Weber number, and that one is Sorgen number. So is there such a kind of a critical extension that can be found? So first, here you see collision that leads to coalescence, here collision that leads to stretching separation. And in order to be a bit faster, I did not show you before, but what I show you here is that we have the temporal resolution actually to really follow the maximum for one type of collision, the maximum, the H D as a function of time, and to really take the maximum. So this we can resolve. And then what we see is that there is actually a critical value. This critical value is found around 3.25. That's in the archive paper I was mentioning. That's in agreement somehow with the numerical simulation of Saroka and Ashkritz. They would have had this dashed line here. They don't have a constant, but that's about the same value. And about very recent results that were published by the group of Castrejon and Pita in GFM, that show also a critical value of 3.25. So this first ingredient is here. And the question now is if we can describe this aspect ratio as a function of the collision parameters. And our idea is the following. This is a sketch of the two droplets that are colliding. And with this relative velocity u, so here you have half u over 2, and here as well. And actually, there is a component that is just head-on that is going to compress them against each other, and a component that is in the stretching direction. And so the idea is to cut this distortion into contribution, and geometrical one that is basically the length of this red line here that you normalize then by the droplet diameter, and a kinetic one, which I'm going to describe after. So here, the length of this red line is pure geometry. You can express it as a function once it is normalized by the droplet diameter as a function of the normalized impact parameter. That would give you this black curve here as a function of x. And you can pretty much linearize it by this function here. This is this green dashed line, at least from 0.3 to 0.8 for the impact parameter, that is the relevant part. This works fairly well. So, okay, we have a geometric configuration to this elongation, that is 2.7x plus 0.5. And now the question is what to do with this kinetic inertial contribution here. So the easiest way, or the naive way to see this, is just to say the initial kinetic energy, that scale that is equal to this, yeah, will be converted into surface energy. And that's the more or less the surface energy of a cylinder of diameter d and length hd. And so that would mean that this is equal to Weber over 24. But of course, this would be a bit too simple, and we have to apply two different corrections here. So the first correction we need to account for is actually the kinetic energy that contributes to this stretching. It's not the kinetic energy of whole droplet. It's only the kinetic energy that is somehow corresponding to this gray volumes here. Not the whole volume, but only the volumes that are not interacting. And again, this is purely geometrical. So this gray volume normalized by the volume of the droplet, you can write it as a function of the impact parameter. That's the exact formula. It's plotted here. And you see that you can pretty much linearize it in this way. So that means for us at first order that this kinetic contribution will be proportional to Weber and proportional to x. Good. Then we need to make a second correction, I told you. And this second correction is actually to account for the viscous losses, because not all this kinetic energy is going to be used to stretch this entity, but part of it is going to be gone in viscous losses. And there it's too complicated, at least for us at the moment, to write scaling laws like we did for the head-on collision. So what we did, we just look at the result from Finotello and all, that's numerical simulation. And what they have plotted is they have basically plotted the total energy, TE. They have pretty much approximated it by the initial kinetic energy. And then they have plotted the remaining energy. So this is 1 minus the dissipated energy divided by the total energy. So that's the energy that remains. In their initial paper, that's plotted as a function of the capillary number, but we can replot it in this way because we know this is, we expect something linear in X, and we are searching something that is a function of the viscosity. So we have decided here to look for an Onesorge number with a certain power. And this works fairly well. So we continue on with this idea. And we say, okay, this kind of normalized extension will have a geometrical contribution of this form and one that is caused by the inertia, which will be proportional to x, to Weber, and to the Onesorge number of the droplet with a certain power. So for now, here we had minus 0.18, but we will let it for now free so that we can readjust if needed. And then we plot our experimental result. What do we obtain? So what you see here is this psi d. So this is only for one Onesorge number, but actually we did this for more as a function of Weber. And what you see is we have the linearity in Weber as expected, and we have also the slopes that are increasing with x as expected. So now what we can do is take every of this slope. This is what we have been doing here. So this SD is simply the derivative of this psi d with Weber. And what we observe is that this is linear in x. So this fits with what we are expecting. And if this is again just for one Onesorge number, but actually we did this for several Onesorge number. And then you also see here in the inset that this varies as Onesorge number at the power minus 0.14, so we are not that far from from the prediction we had from Finotello's data. And at the end, if we allow this exponent n to be adjusted with a mean square fit, then we obtain a perfect agreement between our experiments, this what we measure, and between the model that is then given by this equation here. So we are quite happy, and we have basically the two ingredients we were looking for, which are on one side the model, which describe this normalized extension as a function of the collision parameters. And on the other side, we know that we have a critical extension, and that beyond the critical extension, we will have the separation, the fragmentation of this merged entity. And so this is basically the limit of the stretching separation, which we have plotted. So the continuous line, our model, it is compared with different models. So from Jiang and all, from Finotello, from Ashkritz, from Gotas. What's important here to realize is that each of these models which we are comparing to, they are normally valid only for one Onnes-Sorge number or a very short range of Onnes-Sorge number. While in our case, the Onnes-Sorge number is included in the model, and so that our model works from Onnes-Sorge number that ranges from 0.008 to 0.3 without any adjusting parameters. So that's very good. And this is, we are very excited about that, and we hope we get this published soon. But actually, we wanted to go a bit further, and we were asking ourselves if this kind of stretching separation can be applied to a different configuration. And the configuration we had in mind was the following. So it's what I call drop jet collision. So you have a continuous jet of one liquid with a stream of drop jet that is colliding. And this is some geometrical argument. I will come back to it. Here, this is the Weber number of the droplet, and in certain case, like you had here, you can have this dropping jet. If you increase the inertia, you can have here this fragmented dropping jet, or you can have here these capsules, or you can have this mixed fragmentation, so the jet and the droplet are fragmented. So I don't want to go too much into the detail, but what we want to do basically is to apply or to check if we can apply the stretching separation concept to the limit between the continuous jet and the droplet are embedded with this fragmented jet and the encapsulated droplet. So to do this, we need a kind of analogy between drop jet fragmentation and the classical drop-drop fragmentation. So this geometrical parameter I was mentioning you, this L jet, is actually the length or the distance between two consecutive impact of a droplet onto the jet. And we can, without going there again too much into the detail, but we can basically say that this is like successive drop-drop collisions, and that each of these drop collisions has a certain impact parameter here, x tilt. We normalize it now with the jet diameter, and so that we obtain instead of this x, this x tilde. Then we ask ourselves, can we also apply the analogy to the maximum extension? Yeah, of is there the same kind of criterion like for drop-drop? So we have our picture, we record, and now we measure the maximum extension of the jet here in this direction. And we do observe that, yes, there is a critical value. When we stay below this critical value of approximately 3, we have the droplet embedded in the continuous jet. But if we are above, then we have this capsule. We are fragmenting the jet. Good. And if you remember what I've been showing you, we had this idea that to describe this normalized extension based on some geometrical consideration and some inertial one for the drop-drop. And so we try now to extend this to the jet situation. So we would have, again, some geometrical aspect and some inertial one. And we would like to keep the same kind of description. And these are the experimental results we obtained for the jet. So what I'm showing you here is the normal extension as a function of the Weber of the drop. So we have again the linearity in Weber, like we expect. We have again the slopes that are increasing with the x tilde now. If we look now for a given slope, so this dpc dweber, it's also linear in x tilde actually here, as we expected. And if we let again this exponent here be adjusted by a fit, we have a perfect agreement between what we measure experimentally in the extension of the jet and what our model that is plotted here is producing. So that means that the result we had found in terms of stretching separation for drop-drop collision, they can actually be applied not only to drop-drop collision, but to drop-jet collision. And the critical extension now is 3 instead of 325. The model is very similar. The geometry is a bit different, but this can be understood since it is a continuous system. And we find the threshold between basically this capsule and this continuous jet. So the gray circle and the crosses in all cases for different jet on a Sorgen number with very good accuracy, actually. So with this, I would like basically to conclude about my talk. I hope you could follow the basic idea, which is to describe the fragmentation thresholds of drop-drop collision in a general and unified manner in order to apply this not only to the two drops, one liquid situation, but to go beyond this case. In the case of the head-on fragmentation, it's just a spring kind analogy with a first compression phase, inertial losses, and then a second phase of relaxation. And depending if this relaxation allows or not to go beyond a certain critical aspect ratio, there is fragmentation or not. This works for two liquids and two droplets, or one liquid and two or three droplets. In the case of the stretching separation here, interestingly, one can apply the same kind of critical extension criteria. And if we go beyond this certain critical value, we have separation, and if we stay below, then we stay in the coalescence situation. And this works not only for drop-drop, but also for drop-jet collisions. I would like to thank actually all the people who worked with this. So some numerical simulation I was mentioning, which were done in the group of Dieter Botte, some student actually from the INSA, which is a research institute in France. They help doing some experiment, especially in the drop-drop and drop-jet collisions. Anne-Sinta Bichler was also helping in the drop-jet collision. David Baumgartner is one of my current PhD students. He did most of the drop-jet collision work. Also, the drop-drop collision with the stretching separation is part of his work. And of course, Günther Brenn and Elise Lorenzo, with whom I worked. I also would like to acknowledge the people who made this possible by funding us. And I would like to thank you all for your kind attention, and thank you very much indeed.
Thank you a lot, Carol. I think that is time for questions. Let's see if, please, if you have any question, you can ask us, or you can write your question in the chat. Let's see, otherwise I can start. First, the audience. Well, I can start then.
Well, I have a question.
You have a question. Good.
So, Carol, this is really interesting. I'm wondering, it looked like all of your videos were for drops that are the same size. What happens when you have different size droplets? And is the relative velocity the right measure, or should it be the relative momentum as these droplets are interacting?
So actually, we have very little very little data with droplets of different sizes, which actually is because of the technique we are using. We are using this piezo-based disturbance of a continuous jet in order to have this stream of droplets. And when you have very different diameters, then you need very different frequencies, and then you cannot... we are using this stroboscopic light, so we have to operate with one frequency, and so you cannot really produce these collisions you are mentioning. So in this case, I of course, it could be that the momentum is then more relevant, but I'm a bit missing the experimental data actually to see more about that. I don't know if this was answering your question. But this might really be that the momentum is more relevant.
Thank you. That was very good.
Are there other questions?
I have a question, but Charles has a question. Charles? Your microphone is muted.
Mine?
No, Charles. No. Anyway, well, Charles is fixing up things. I have a question, Carol. Very nice talk. In the last video and the video that you showed, there is a tube in the way of the black-colored droplets. How much does that kind of an arrangement affect? I mean, there seems to be a third element sort of controlling at least the initial onset of what happens. Is that true, or am I reading your pictures a little bit wrong?
I'm not sure about which picture you
are. The very last slide that you have. Is
the
that
the last one? Let me go back. Maybe I can share the screen again. So that should work. So these are back. You mean of the drop jet or of the drop?
No, that very last slide. You see, when you play that at the very left hand, is that a tube or is that the liquid jet coming and hitting? Is that a jet?
So that what you see is a jet, and then it's a droplet. And the reason why actually this is not a steady state, but you have changing, is because we are applying a ramp of pressure into either the droplet or the jet. I'm not sure anymore. So that is changing this basic spacing between two consecutive impact for the jet, and therefore you are crossing this limit, crossing this limit where you have satellite or no satellite. But it is a jet with some droplets, yes.
I see. Now, one more question is that as you go downstream, will this arrangement be stable that you have one droplet embedded in the other one?
Yes, this is stable. What is for sure not stable forever, one has also to see this, is simply when you have this arrangement here where you have the droplet into the jet, and they are really embedded at the position they come in. This remains a liquid jet. So at a certain point, you will have some noise and some plateau relay instability will come in, and you will lose this discontinuity of the pure jet. But like you would have with any free-falling jet, actually.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bala.
Can I ask a question?
Please.
So from what I see, basically you neglect the medium in which droplets are moving. So it's probably air. But what if you use, your hypothesis should of course change if you have a more viscous or more dense medium, like for instance, oil in water or water in oil. So in this case, I think that the medium should be considered, right? So you've not investigated different properties of the medium.
No. The idea is really to get rid a bit of this third carrying phase, so that to do everything in air and to say like air is vacuum compared to our liquid, and so that simplifies a lot.
And a very quick second question. I've seen, all your drops before interacting with each other are spherical. So you are considering drops which are smaller than the size required to deform due to the shear.
Yes, they have been having some funny shape at the plateau instability, but we'll leave them time to find
configure.
A spherical okay. shape. And they are small enough so that the capillary pressure is actually quite high.
Strong enough.
Yes.
I have a question related to what Alfredo is saying now. When you are trying to simulate the drop-drop collisions, you have the problem of considering the gas, so the air, not only really another fluid, but the only air, which is that really important. In many cases, you are not able to reproduce the results, like the bouncing and so on, because you're not considering properly the air layer. So, but we didn't mention really about this effect, the problem of this effect, which is really very strong, I think. Can you comment about the effect of the air layer between the droplets and also between the jet and the incoming droplets?
So I believe this effect is very important when you are close to the bouncing regime. So when you are basically have competition between the air drainage and the deformation of your droplet of your jet, I would tend to think that when we have enough inertia like we have now, this is not really important anymore. On the other side, if you would really look in details, especially in the drop-drop collision, for example, if there is a small bubble that is encapsulated, which we can resolve experimentally, I think there, if you start to look at this kind of things, then be an issue. Or you would have to consider it. But for the separation, fragmentation, not fragmentation, I think we have enough inertia that it is second order or even beyond.
And there is there a kind of threshold when is this gas effect should be considered or something like, when the inertia, the Weber number maybe is very high, then you don't need to consider the gas or maybe when another parameter, I'm thinking.
Most likely there is one. I did not really consider this. Maybe one should look at the kinetic pressure of your air and compare it to the capillary pressure maybe of your drop or something like that.
Mm-hmm. But I don't remember a paper about that, so with the threshold somehow.
With a clear threshold, no. I think there are quite some bouncing paper while discussing this. Yeah. But I don't have in mind a clear threshold neither, sorry.
Yeah. So other questions? Let me see in the chat. No, we don't have. It is only my message. Let's see if we have questions from the channel, YouTube. No,
there's no questions from YouTube.
Okay.
There's a question in the chat now.
Now there is a question in the chat, yes. Whether there are any lamellar rupture during the disc formation in three droplet collision?
We did not observe this, maybe I have to also again share the screen so that we can better. This will come. The issue we have with the free droplet collision is not so much that the lamella is rupturing because we don't go to this very high inertia. The separation or the limit between this add-on coalescence and separation is not that high in terms of inertia that we go there where it ruptures. But the issue what we have, if you look at this movie here, there was a bit of an impact parameter that was not totally zero because then the disc you are forming here somewhere in the middle, the disk you would form here in the middle would be too big, and it would start to touch with the disk before and after. So we are forced here actually to give a bit of an eccentricity, because if they remain really aligned like they do here, then this is now too big, and they will just touch each other. So you cannot have one triplet and the next one, they are not independent anymore of each other. So this is a limitation we have. But the lamella rupture, I've not observed it.
Okay, let's see. So I think that if there are no questions, we can close the session, I guess. Let me see, let's wait 1 second more if we have any other action. Okay, so I think that is done. Okay, thank you so much, Carol, for this very interesting presentation. It was kind of a resume of all. Someone raised hand.
No, it was just clapping.
Okay. I said maybe it is another question. No, thank you.
No, I was just waving my hand, say bye. thanks everyone for joining.
Thanks again for the kind invitation. Yeah, that was also a pleasure actually giving this talk. And I hope it was interesting for you.
At the given moment, we had 70 participants.
Yeah.
We had 70 participants from here and more than 20 on the YouTube channel. So that makes almost 90. Yeah. And this reminds me, while I just jump in and steal the floor to Marco for a second. Thank you very much, Carol. And remind you all, November the 2nd, there will be another seminar of this series by Professor Arezuar Decani. So thanks a lot again, Carol, and I let Marco finish.
No, but it's already, let's say, done. Thank you again. Thank you, Alfredo and Bala, and for the organization, and Gael for the logistics and administration of this webinar. It's really an excellent event, and I'm very happy to participate to those events that are spreading the science of multiphase flows in the world. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Bye. Thanks all.